Okay, we're back with our favorite part of the show, the weekly news, and Pap is just back from his vacation to the Galapagos Islands off of Ecuador, right?
Yeah, well, they call it the Galapagos down here.
Well, I was just trying to speak Southern, man.
Yeah, what a phenomenal trip. It makes, you know what it does to me? The whole time I was down there, I was thinking, I am so glad that for the last 20 years, Bobby Kennedy has been working on environmental issues, because this place was phenomenal. Just absolutely phenomenal. Hey, look, let me talk. You know, while I was gone, I heard that they need to start a Glenn Beck suicide watch, man. I don't know if you followed these crying spurts that he's had on television, but, you know, Glenn Beck goes on last Friday with Glenn Beck Friday. And the whole idea of it, Bobby, is he calls it his 9/12 project. And what it is, it's his response to liberalism, where he seems convinced that progressive politics is going to destroy the country. So the creepiest thing about it is he starts talking, and then he bursts out into tears the first time, and everybody, okay, you know, that's all right. But it was inappropriate. It was totally done at an odd moment. The next time he's talking, he bursts out in his ear. It almost looks like he is unstable, like he's losing it. So what's happening is people are starting to put things together. Okay, first of all, he's got this persistent sadness, this crying. He's got this excessive anxiety. He has this excessive anger. He has this difficulty focusing and paying attention to what he's talking about. If you look at all of that, this guy should be on a suicide watch. He really should. Did you catch this by any chance? Did you watch these crying spats that took place?
Well, my take on him is very different, because I think he is, clearly he's mentally ill, but I... But I find it kind of endearing, because he talks about it. He talks about his addiction and his mental illness and stuff. And I find it kind of charming that he does that, and that, you know.
But Bobby,
and
is...
that he enjoys success on TV. And he's now brought, unfortunately, he's brought Fox back to, you know, because Fox's numbers dropped precipitously during the election.
Yeah.
But they're back again with Glenn, and they're at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Thank God we don't have to watch it.
It's one thing if it seems genuine. Go back and take a look at it, though. They actually focus the cameras on his eyes ahead of time. It's like, okay, he's getting ready to say something. Then they'll focus on his eyes, and all of a sudden it's like he cries on cue. This is, to me, it is the weirdest thing. Look, anytime you are creepier than Bill O'Reilly, that is, the creep factor is almost off the edge. That's what I'm seeing with this guy. I really, seriously, they ought to start some kind of suicide watch on the guy. Well, look, what's
speaking of creepy? Yeah. Bobby Jindal.
Oh my God.
Your friend and neighbor, governor of
the exorcist.
Louisiana.
The exorcist.
Right. So anyway, he's the great hope. He's the great hope for the Republican Party.
Yeah.
He's the leader that they chose to reply to Barack Obama. And he, as it turns out, is a crook who has appointed over 200 campaign contributors to high state commissions in the state of Louisiana.
Right.
And these are people whose only qualification in most of these cases appears to be the fact that they gave Bobby Jindal money.
Yeah, well, I mean, the list tells it. This guy named Roland Toops of Baton Rouge gave Jindal $5,000 just 2 months before he was appointed to the Board of Regents. Then you had this fellow Baton Rouge native, Todd Graves, $5,000. Seems like $5,000 is the magic number for Bobby Jindal appointing you to whatever you want. And unfortunately, this has been going on a long time in Louisiana, so they actually put a bill up that says, look, we can't do this anymore. You can't buy office. And Jindal, I don't know if you know the backstory on here, but Jindal actually came into office with this mantra that he was going to stop corruption in Louisiana. It's just had exactly the opposite effect. I mean, this guy named Jacob Gherardini, he also Thibodeau, $5,000, and he's appointed to the Freshwater District Board of Directors. I mean, if you go down this list, it seems like $5,000 is the magic number for Bobby Jindal. So,
okay, let's talk about Bush. Another ex-official. You missed the news last week because you were down in the Galapagos.
Galapagos, Bobby. It's
right, okay. And the you missed the news, but Lawrence Wilkinson, who is the chief aide to Colin Powell, during the Bush administration came out and did an article saying that many of the Guantanamo detainees, perhaps a majority of them, were innocent people who had been corralled in Afghanistan because the United States had, because they were in the wrong place at the wrong time, and the United States had offered Pakistanis a bounty of $5,000 a head for anybody they turned in and claimed was a war criminal. And that not only did the United States government quickly realize that they were innocent, but it kept them in Guantanamo anyway, believing that it could extract valuable information from them that might escalate our knowledge of what was happening in Afghanistan. Just like,
in other words, they knew, Bobby, what you're saying, they knew that these people did not qualify as enemy combatants. They held them there anyway in hopes that something would just shake, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the quotes from Wilkinson. It said it did not matter if the detainees was innocent. Indeed, because he lived in Afghanistan and was captured on or near a battle area, he must know something of importance. He said, Wilkinson continued in his blog, that, quote, intelligent analysts hope to gather sufficient information about a village, a region, or a group of individuals that the dots could be connected and terrorists or their plots could later be identified. So knowing that they had captured innocent people, taken them away from their families, and many of these people, incidentally, are still in prison six or seven years later, and with the United States government knowing that they're innocent, and yet they're being held by intelligence officials. My question is, you know, what does this do to us? What does this mean for America? I grew up, Mike, with during the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Bay of Pigs, when Castro was holding 1,500 Bay of Pigs from the 1,500 members of the Cuban Brigade who had invaded during the first couple of months, the Kennedy administration, who had invaded Cuba and then been captured. And, you know, people in our country were horrified that in Castro's prisons, although they weren't being tortured, that people were being mistreated, that they weren't, and that there were people there at all, that there were political prisoners at all. Here, we're taking political prisoners. Not Fidel Castro.
Not Hitler or Stalin or Lenin.
Right, are torturing people in Cuba. And this week, adding to the chorus, Vijay Padmanabhan, who was a second insider, and he was the chief counsel for the government on the Guantanamo litigation.
So
and he says, his quote is that the Bush administration panicked after 9/11 and began torturing prisoners. And he said it was, quote, foolish for the Bush administration to declare that detainees were beyond the reach of the United States, international laws, and the Geneva Convention. And, quote, Guantanamo was one of the worst overreactions of the Bush administration.
Okay, let me pick up with something. We have to take a quick break, but I want to pick up with that topic when we come back. Stand by. We'll be right back.